Thank you. Good morning, and thank you for coming to this quite early morning meeting. And thank you to Sharjah Art Foundation and Sharjah Film Platform for an invitation to moderate this panel. I am Nicolas Fedorov. I'm programmer at Film Marseille International Film Festival. And let me introduce briefly our speakers, because after they will present by themselves their work. First, Yara Lee, who is a filmmaker, activist or activist filmmaker. She will tell us which part of her work is most important. And she's a founder of Culture of Resistance Network Foundation, formerly named Caipirinha Foundation, and the foundation named after her feature film. It was in 2010, Culture of Resistance, dedicated to, I would say, creative act of resistance all over the world. And after, we'll have Malek Rassamni, who's a writer, producer, and filmmaker, and who have a multimedia project dedicated to natives and refugee camps. And now it's a film, I'm sorry, I don't remember the titles, Spaces of Exception. And he will speak about this project, expanded documentary or not, And Rania Stefan, who is from Lebanon. She's a filmmaker and editor, and will speak about her former film, and especially from the three disappearances of Swadosny, which have been supported by Sharjah Art Foundation and presented here in 2011 in the context of exhibition. And that's why perhaps she's here as filmmaker and experimental filmmaker. So perhaps Yara, you can start our discussion and to present your own work.
I'm from Brazil. My parents are Korean, and I make films all over the world about resistance movements. And unlike him, he's having a screening here tonight. I won't, so I'm gonna show clips of some of my films to give you an idea context. I will start with Cultures of Resistance.
Can we have lights off, please? Avid lights?
정치가 아니라 문화입니다. 어떤 것에 대한 저항이 아니라 자기 자신이 하나 어떤 것을 만들어야 되죠.
ناس بلعب في الريموت بدي اعرف ايش عدد الموت هون مش سامع ولا صوت اتس التليفون اسال لانه ولا حد سائل سواء سياسي او دبلوماسي قاعدين على الكراسي وبتحدثوا بروحوا بحطوا روسهم وبتمددوا بالبيوت في لبنان وغزه عم بتهدموا اجا الوقت نرفع معكوس لكل العالم لانه راح يضلوا يعيدوا عمره باحياما فليش
Não dá para assistir esse tipo de barbaridade. Não dá para assistir as pessoas sendo assassinadas desse jeito e não sentir nada.
Le désespoir, évidemment, il faut qu'il soit actif. Mais c'est peut-être l'aiguillon de l'activité.
La poesía no derroca gobierno, pero sí abre conciencias y corazones.
¡Vamos! artiste est naturellement un homme à chaleur humaine. Et donc qui généralement ne prêche que l'amour, qui ne prêche généralement que la paix, qui ne prêche généralement que l'égalité entre hommes, qui ne prêche généralement que tout ce qui est beau.
Just do something, even if it's once a month, even if it's once a year.
We are at this watershed of human evolution. We will either continue to work on the path of resource waste, resource monopoly, and therefore resource conflicts, and have no workable societies, or we will make a transition to resource prudence, conservation, equity, sharing, peace. If we don't change the path, there is no survival for the human species.
Has been my raison d'être. As I mentioned, I'm from Brazil, but I lived in the U.S. And when the U.S. decided to attack Iraq, I was so outraged. So I decided to come to the Middle East and understand things from that perspective. And ever since, you know, I've been trying to report on resistance cultures around the world. And I scratch my head and I say, well, state, you know, terrorists, you know, governments will use weapons. So what are we going to use to combat that? So I decided that creativity is the way to go. I come from arts and culture world, and I realized that you have to use arts and culture for something beyond arts and culture. So I've been in this path about trying to gauge young people to get more proactive, because at the end of the day, you know, you guys inherit this, and you gotta clean up the mess. So it's been, you know, my path going through different countries and reporting and getting young people to work together. And in 2000, actually, I was in the Afghan refugee camps in Pakistan, and they started throwing stones and Kalashnikov in the air against our film crew. And I was shocked, and I was like, I'm here trying to do something to show the world what's happening and, you know, why this reaction. But then they started screaming, saying, every day, filmmakers, journalists, photographers, and nothing changes. And it was a wake-up call, so that's why I realized that beyond even denouncing, we have to actually try to do things in a more proactive way as a filmmaker as well. So that's why I started the Cultures of Resistance Foundation, so we do work with the people we report on a long-term basis. So we create scholarships, we support hospitals, we do environmental programs with many activists, ecologists around the world. And I think this is very important, because we as filmmakers, you know, we take these horrible stories and we go to film festivals or beautiful places like here, we get awards and we leave people as we found them. So for me, it has been very important to have this element of my work. So it's filmmaking, arts and culture, activism, and, you know, humanitarian work together as a combination. Urban violence, resource war, this is all what it's about all over the world. And the greatest shame is that we humans are losing humanity. So, you know, this is my quest to get people to be more solidarity and compassionate about everything. I got the sign, it's time to go to the next. We only have 10 minutes. Yeah.
Lights, please.
Hey, brothers, make some for this. Some of this for, give me the onion. No, give me the onion. Give me the onion.
Mais ils ont shooté, il y a des trous dans le ventre.
Mais quoi,
mais merde.
Well, This is a scene of the Mavi Marmara 2010 when we were in the middle of international waters, and in the middle of the night, the Israeli commandos came and attacked our boats. I was on the Mavi Marmara, the Turkish boat, and they killed 9 humanitarian aid workers and injure many of us. And you know, a lot of times people think, even my cameraman who was with me at that time, he thought he was coming to an adventure. And I says, no, this is not an adventure, this is war. And he was like, oh, forget it, Yada, how can they take over this boat? We are hundreds of people. I said, you don't know what the Israeli government can do. And they send helicopters with commandos, Zodiacs, masked man, with live ammunition. We were all prepared to tear gas, jail, but we never thought they were gonna start killing people, and they did. And as always, nothing happened, you know? So this is my outrage. I mean, how can war criminals, state terrorist governments do things and nothing happens because they're so powerful and they have the endorsement of very other strong governments? And, you know, since I have the honor of being a very independent filmmaker, I'm not even working with broadcast companies or people financing or supporting my films. I do very grassroots on the road and low budget. I'm able to be very outspoken, and I'm very, very thankful that a Gulf country is inviting me to be here, because normally, you know, I'm very much rejected by, you know, the strong governments, always deported, thrown in jail, banned, and to be welcomed here is like, wow. You know, because for me it's very important to not preach to the converted, to just speak to people who already think like me. It's not a point. So it's very important for me to be here in the UAE to, you know, discuss issues like this, because this is just very outrageous, and there is no international law, and we should really fight against this reality. So we can go to the next one.
Burkina Faso, pays des hommes intègres. Et vous savez que les 27 ans de Blaise ont travaillé, désintégré la Burkina Faso. Et pour nous, nous sommes à l'ère de la restauration de cette valeur.
C'était une première fois au Burkina Faso que les femmes initient elles-mêmes une marche.
La résistance, quand il y a eu les militaires qui tiraient, moi j'ai reçu des menaces parce que je faisais mon travail et que je publiais, j'envoyais les images très loin pour que les gens, le monde entier, sachent ce qui se passait dans mon pays.
On n'était pas des cinéastes cinéma, on était des cinéastes activistes. Mes amis disaient qu'il avait la caméra dans sa main droite et l'autre main, il avait un air. C'était le point.
Pour moi, ce qui fait le lien social aujourd'hui au Burkina, c'est la question culturelle.
Si vous dites de manière très sérieuse des choses, des idées, peu de gens vous écoutent. Et quand vous le faites avec de la poésie, vous le faites avec de l'humour, vous le faites avec l'art, eh bien, vous sublimez ce message-là.
Nous, on n'a que le micro actuellement pour dire ce qu'on pense.
Those people, they didn't listen to our music because our music is like a bullet to them. It's like we are shooting them.
Il y a des gens qui ont perdu leur vie dans cette affaire et ils sont morts pour qu'il y ait un petit peu de changement ici.
C'est la révolution nationale. Et comme le disait Thomas Sankara lui-même, tout ce qui est imaginable par l'esprit de l'homme est réalisable par cet même homme.
Well, a lot of times I think we feel a little disempowered. We feel like the negative forces are so strong that there is nothing we can do as citizens. So I go to this tiny little country in West Africa called Burkina Faso, and I realize that when people unite, they can get things done. And this is a real example. This is not political analysis. This is not, you know, speculation. This is reality on the ground. through popular revolution, they were able to remove a president who was in power for 27 years, who wanted to stay longer. So people were just like, enough is enough. Even the women went with the spoons, the wooden spoons, and through the power of music, film, photography, dance, activists, they removed this president. So we can do it. You know, I think countries all over the world feel just completely like hopeless, but here is an example, and I hope with this story will inspire people to action. And again, it's through arts and culture, because this is the weapon we have. So, do I still have a little bit of time? The end.
Thank you, everybody, for having me. Thank you, Shoja Film Platform, for it. Thank you, Ira, for your work. I think it's really important. So, and there's some parallels, obviously, between what we do. I have a short... okay, here we go. So yeah, I mean, I'll get up and do it from here.
Yeah.
I mean, okay. So does this work? Oh, okay, cool. So The Native and the Refugee is a multimedia film project that my collaborator Matt Peterson and I began 5 years ago. And it's basically has been, I think as Ira was saying, it's not enough to simply go to places, document them, show them at film festivals, and that's it. So actually the idea behind the project was to kind of create a platform where we could make work and form partnerships and kind of exhibit work in different contexts. So ideas of audience and ideas of where the work is screened, I think are very important in our practice that we've developed over the last 5 years. So that's the idea. It's a broad comparison. It's a comparison of Native Americans in the United States and Palestinian refugees. And this photo is from Nahr al-Bared, which is a Palestinian refugee camp in northern Lebanon in Tripoli. And it's from 1952. And as you can see, the housing looks a lot, they're tents basically. And they look a lot like the traditional teepee of a lot of the Plains Native, Plains Indians. So in this kind of photo, you can see at least symbolically some of the comparisons. So I normally our presentations are taken into account the themes of the project, but this presentation is slightly meta. It's more of a presentation about our process than it is about the themes of the project, but I just wanted one slide to kind of illustrate the project itself. So this is kind of very, very basic. As you can see on the left, the slow, all of the white land, oh, actually, no, the kind of dark colored land is native, and then over time, we can see the gradual settler colonialism of the United States swallowing up native land until all that's left are the reservations, which are the kind of sole remaining areas of any sort of native sovereignty. Similarly, on down on both sides, you can see the kind of slow deterioration or the slow eating away of Palestinian land by Israeli settler colonialism throughout the 20th century, all the way from the kind of UN proposal for two states after the 1948 catastrophe, all the way up until the present day, where not only is there just the West Bank and Gaza Strip, but even the West Bank has been consolidated into just a series of blocks sort of snaking between Israeli settlements. So a big issue with, and this is the title of the film, one thing we chose to focus on was not simply a comparison or historical comparison of Native Americans and Palestinians, but a very, very site-specific approach. So focusing specifically on Native reservations and Palestinian refugee camps as spaces of exception. Can you guys hear me? I mean, do you hear me without the microphone? Okay. So Native reservations and Palestinian refugee camps. Native reservations are kind of the sole remaining territorial entities, as I said before, of Native sovereignty. Some of them are prisoner of war camps. Some of them are territories that Native people have defended and established some kind of governance on within the United States. And similarly, Palestinian refugee camps are also kind of important places within the struggle, within the Palestinian struggle. And they're also kind of, in many countries, in Lebanon, for example, there's spaces outside the sovereignty of the Lebanese state. So they're places that are kind of extra-national. They exist outside of the nation state, and they symbolize the wider struggle. The Palestinian refugee camp in particular is the sole remaining reminder of the Nakba, and it symbolizes the right of return, which is obviously a very contentious issue. Oftentimes throughout the political conflicts that have happened over the years, both the reservation and the refugee camp have been focal points. So for example, this is a picture of Yarmouk. Yarmouk was the biggest Palestinian refugee camp. It housed about 300,000 people in Damascus, and it was totally destroyed in a kind of apocalyptic scenario, as you can see here in this famous photo. And so even though the Syrian conflict is not about Palestine or Israel per se, Palestinians find themselves in a particularly vulnerable position as kind of stateless people, and the refugee camps always find themselves as centers of attention within different conflicts, as we can see that over here. So this is basically what I was saying before, this idea of comparing the two spaces of the refugee camp and the reservation as places that tell us a lot about the nation states that we inhabit, tell us about concepts of citizenship, who gets excluded, who gets included, and kind of our living critique of the nation states in which they exist. So this, for example, is from Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota, and this is the occupation of Wounded Knee. What's very interesting about the reservations and the Palestinian refugee camps is that these are kind of mini states. So for example, within the reservation, you'll have a tribal government, and then there's resistance to the tribal government within the reservation. So in the case of the Standing Rock occupation, there was a kind of a dictator within the reservation who, a lot of people were killed, I think over 200 people. And so they wanted to overthrow the dictator of the reservation and invited the American Indian Movement, a pan-United States coalition of Native people, to come and kind of fight the dictator within the reservation. And then the FBI kind of sent in troops to back up the dictator. So it's almost like something that would have happened in a South American country, but within a small territorial entity like a reservation. And so I think these are very intense and kind of miniature versions of what happens in larger states. And I thought that was interesting. So now a bit more to our practice. So as you can read here, we've experimented with different kinds of methods of making our work. It wasn't just simply a case where we went in, said we're gonna make one movie, and there is a feature that will be premiering tonight, but it wasn't just that we're like, all right, we're gonna make this one movie, and that's it. Actually, along the way, we made several short films with the purpose of screening them in different spaces and kind of circulating them around and generating kind of conversation and hopefully connections. So for example, when we went to shoot in Lebanon and in Palestine and in Jordan, we had already produced two short films from the native reservations that we had been to with the express purpose of showing them to the Palestinian communities that we were filming. So it wasn't just simply a matter of we're gonna come shoot, you know, actually this is our work and we wanna kind of form connections between, first of all, there's this issue that me as an American citizen and Matt, we can travel to these different places quite easily because we have the citizenship and we have the funds. Whereas for Native people, it can be difficult for them to visit other reservations within the United States. And obviously, it's different for Palestinians to go to other countries. Hence, I got thrown off by the two-minute reading. But it's even difficult, obviously, super difficult for Palestinians and Natives to form a dialogue within each other. So we tried to make work about Palestinians for Natives and vice versa, to show different people what's going on in different places and kind of establish lines of communication. And there were things like that.
Yes, excuse me, but like you have given us the context, and perhaps we. Yes, one more thing, and after we'll speak about your project and how you manage this multimedia project.
All right, so I'm just gonna in 1 minute do the rest of it real quick, speed. So we've made a bunch of short films, History of the Camp, Walls of Bethlehem, different styles. Some of them are more journalistic, some of them are propagandistic, some of them are more poetic, some of them are just simply documentation. Of riots or of a place. So we've actually done a bunch of short films throughout the way. We've collaborated with different kinds of groups. We see ourselves not just as documenters or filmmakers, but as collaborators with organizations on the ground, and we try to work together, as well as with different artists and filmmakers. And finally, we've shown the films in different kinds of spaces. So we've shown the films in universities, including, very interestingly, a Kurdish philosophical academy in Syria, and a film commune in Syria, which was super interesting. So we've done them in universities, different art spaces around the world, and last but not least, in the reservations and camps themselves, as I've spoken about before. And we working, yeah, obviously on solidarity. I'm not going to go through it. And finally, this picture is from Standing Rock. We had went to Pine Ridge 2 years before the Standing Rock occupation happened. I don't know who's aware of the whole Standing Rock movement, but we had been in Pine Ridge, and then we went to Standing Rock, made some shorts about Standing Rock, and we had already known a lot of the people from Pine Ridge who were organizing in Standing Rock, and this is a picture of a Palestinian flag at Standing Rock. So I think it kind of symbolizes the essence of global solidarity that we hope to underscore with our project. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now, Rania Stefan, some words about your work.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Rania Stefan. I'm a filmmaker from Beirut. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you for coming. Nicolas said that I'm a filmmaker and editor. And in fact, I'm not an editor. I just edit my own films. And editing has become with, and sometimes I edit other people's films because they like the way I edit. And editing has become, over the years, a very great concern of mine. And I think more and more editing as a resistance tool regarding the image and regarding the flow of images we're surrounded with in this world. My practice has two sides. I do raw documentaries who have very deep social concerns about my surroundings, mainly in Lebanon, where I shoot and edit my own work. And also one of my main concern is the use of archival images, how these images are reused, circulate, and can be kind of put in regards to other images. And so now my practice has extended to the visual arts. I've become also a contemporary artist, and even in my still image works, there is this idea of editing, how images can collude, be superimposed, or be put in regards to one another. Because I think it's not, now the reality we're living in is not the lack of images. We are completely like overwhelmed by images. It's very important to go and get images where they need to be shown, like my colleagues are doing. But on the other hand, we have to reflect also about the way these images are circulated, who is looking at them, how we are showing them, and what editing can do in order to expand the consciousness of the spectator, and in what way a filmmaker can position him or herself to push the consciousness to open up further relation with the image. And this can be done through the editing. For me, editing is not only a technical process. It's not like just aligning images and sounds. There is it's a kind of very complex process. I'm very inspired by, I was very inspired and by Godard's first basic text called Montage Mon Beau Souci, which he wrote in Le Cahier du Cinéma in 1961, where he put editing right next to mise en scène, which means you don't only shoot images. After shooting comes the editing, where your thinking is elaborated. When you edit, it's not only a technical process to align images and sound. There is a completely visceral, for me, it's a completely visceral relation to the image. The image is a living thing. The image is kind of palpitates. It's like a kind of entity that is very much alive, and you have to kind of establish a very kind of living relation with it, and keep this image alive and transmit this kind of vivacity into the editing. The editing can be very layered. It's a profound kind of layering of meanings and of relationships. Images can resonate with one another. You don't need to just be in a storytelling mode. You don't need to be in just one type of form. For me, every 5 minutes, every film has to create its own form. And this is when, as a filmmaker, resistance comes in, because we have to resist also in a formal way. We have to resist in the way we do not conform to set forms. We do not conform to set reflection about how a film should be. Every film has to bring in its own form. Every film has to be alive. And for me, it's through editing is a way of thinking. It's thinking through the images.
And perhaps we could see the first clips to have an idea of the work.
I can see the first clip. I'll show you the trailer of Saad Husni, which kind of summarizes the film.
ايه اللي جرى؟
مش فاكرة.
حاولي تفتكري. احكي لي انا بتشوفي ايه؟ افتكري.
لسه ما عرفتش اسمك.
If you want to have time for the next one.
The next one is longer. Just a bit, okay. I can speak over it. It's my the project I did after Saad Husni, and also which was supported by Sharjah Art Foundation. It's my own archive revisited through the mediation of a fictional detective from Laura.
A silver sun burned through the sky like a huge magnifying glass. It was the hottest Sunday in my recollection. I felt as if I were the only human being left in New York. For with Laura's horrible death, I was alone.
I just wanted to mention that in this clip, I discovered by editing that the first Alice in Wonderland, 1903, and Laura, which is 1943, there is a whole ballet for like five more minutes between Alice and Macpherson, and they kind of navigate in the space as if it's a choreography. And I just did was to superimpose these two images, and I discovered by editing that these the spaces were kind of orchestrated in such a way that the two characters, which are separated by 50 years of time, kind of move together in this space I created like a ballet without any intervention. It's just by putting these two images together. So one can use images in different ways and try to kind of explore further what the multiplicity of images and how images collude in a different way. Here I kind of put 50 years of cinema history in one frame, and it was very interesting to see how this kind of harmonizes in one space.
Thank you, Raya. So now the talk is about expanded documentary. As you know, we know expanded cinema. So it was a book, a famous book, published 40 years ago, something 50 years ago now, almost. And it was about the different ways of making films, and not film, but for the author, it was about technologies and new cinema in a way of making a new consciousness of being as a spectator and or a different audience and different way of making films. And I would ask you, because we know documentary is often considered as a genre with its own rules, what you can do, what you can't do, where are the boundaries, not here and here, possible and here not possible. And I would like to ask you, in your very different way of working, we have seen in this presentation, how do you consider this idea of expanded and expanded documentary? Who wants to start?
I just say one word. I mean, my teacher and my mentor in cinema, who's a big documentarist, always tells me documentary is the school of freedom. I mean, this is in this sense, I think it's very expanded. Documentary, you can push all the borders of genre, of cross genres, of way of thinking, of mixing images, of reflecting on the images in such a very rich and different ways. So for me, really, documentary is the school of freedom.
You were asking, Doc? You were asking if I'm more activist, filmmaker activist, and definitely
just to provoke you for the beginning.
Yeah, definitely for me, filmmaking is a tool for the activist, which is, I think, you know, if we can use art as a tool for many different things, this is a great thing, and this is what I try to do through filmmaking. But I am so like thankful to editors, because when you are a documentarian, you produce terabytes of footage, and then you have to give to the editor. And they are the most important people in the filmmaking process of documentaries. And I think a lot of times they are not acknowledged. So in my case, for example, my editors are my god. Every time people invite me to film festivals, I give the airfare to them. I say, no, you go, you're the king. Because they are the ones that make magic happen. You know, until then, it's just raw footage. It's like bringing them a rock. And they are the ones that will sculpt into something marvelous. Thank you so much for your work.
Yeah, I think for me, part of what expanded documentary is not just in the form of the documentary, but also in the space in which it's exhibited, how it's exhibited. So for example, installations versus a normal screening. Or in New York, a big part of Matt and I, how we met, was there was a big culture of film collectives. And so it was often not just about showing, but like curating works around other works. In our kind of practice, we oftentimes will show we'll do a presentation about the project, just speaking directly, and then maybe show some shorts and then have a discussion afterwards. And so for me, I think the discussion is actually a big part of the film, and not a simple Q&A format where the director is posited as the leader and then you ask him, but kind of everybody sits down in a circle or something like that, and just an open discussion. A big part of the culture in New York that I came out of was a lot of screenings and discussions, and people would make dinner and come back and talk more and have really long screenings sometimes, the whole length of a day. So I think there's different ways to experiment, not only in terms of the film itself, but in the exhibitions, how it's exhibited, to whom, how, in what context, et cetera. And I think that can be a big part of expanding documentary.
And yes, because with the idea of expanded, we think generally about the way of seeing the film. That perhaps, yeah, there is a the other aspect at the beginning, when how you make your film, how you involve the people. As you said, your people who you met in different places collaborate with you, and it's another way of making films too. No,
absolutely, definitely. Yeah, I mean, certainly, and also making films with them in mind. Because I think what we have, I think we don't think a lot about, we assume that there's an audience, and the audience that we usually think of is this kind of anonymous, probably Western spectator in our head. But what does it mean to make Palestinian films for Native people, right? Or vice versa, or make films for those communities. So to see film as a document that can be transmitted between different audiences, as opposed to this process of taking and then giving it to this anonymous film festival kind of spectator. So I think that's also part of it. And yeah, I mean, certainly issues of collaborating. We didn't give cameras to people for them to film, but there was certainly a kind of open process where we would sit down with people and say, okay, what do you want us to document? Not simply we want to see this, we want to see that, but we would kind of meet with people before, we'd show them our work. I think a lot of people wanted to work with us because of the comparison aspect, because there was a sense that their struggle, their story was being connected to another story, not simply being represented, right? It was part of a process of actively trying to build alliances and global solidarity, not simply raising awareness in a kind of neutral fashion or something. So I think that was a big part of it, sitting with people, asking them, well, what would you want us to shoot? What do you think is interesting? What do you want us to document? And then showing them the work after. Yeah.
I think this thing about the global solidarity and the similarity of all the struggles is very important, because despite the fact that I make films in a lot of countries, there are other countries that always say, why don't you make a film about us? But then I come to realize that we have the same issues. It's always the same stories.
Absolutely.
And then through these examples of some of the films we made, other countries find their connection and extend their solidarity and compassion. I think that's very important. The other thing you were talking about, space, I think it's very interesting too, because for me, you know, at the beginning I wanted to be like with a distributor and be in all the same places that all the filmmakers consider prestigious, but then I realized my niche is different. So now I'm so excited, you know, instead of going to Cannes, I show the film in Afghanistan.
Right.
Instead of getting a Palme d'Or or an Oscar, I get an award from Zimbabwe. And this has been my quest too, to bring the films to different corners of the world, off the beaten path, countries that are not acknowledged. So we try to show the films in countries that people don't even consider when you're an independent filmmaker, and that has been an immense pleasure to be in over 100 countries every year, and to countries that people have not even heard about. So this is very exciting.
And you had to some collaborative works with people, and you gave them cameras, and they have some.
Yeah, sometimes we do that. Like in Syria, for example, when I made the first film, when the war was not a war and it was just beginning, and we wanted documentation, so we basically, you know, send cameras to Syrian filmmakers inside Syria, and we do that in Afghanistan as well. We gave cameras to people, and I think this is a good way of, you know, not only being a filmmaker, but empowering other people to tell their own stories, which I think is very important.
And you, Rania, because we spoke all the way of making film and the way of reception to So for the reception of the film, and your film are both shown in cinema and in installation in.
I'm a one-woman production company. I mean, my films, I do them all by myself in my house. So it's very much a kind of like tactile relation to the medium. I film myself, I edit myself, I distribute myself, and if I have the chance to show in festivals, I do. If not, I also show in museums, in cinematheques, in all kinds of in refugee camps, and I distribute myself. So it's a very much a kind of single-handed endeavor. But I think it gives me the freedom to really do the film I have in mind in the utmost like way I find it best for the film, and it doesn't it's a fragile position, it's a marginal position, but I'm very happy to not only be on the margin of genres, on the margin of production processes, but also always to be aware and to be on the edge in order not to fall into any kind of trap, and always be vigilant. So one is always aware of not to be recuperated in ways.
And when you do a film, you think about the way it will be shown, space, exhibition space, dark, screening room.
Now I have the I have the advantage of having a gallery, which is a very recent thing. So my film has kind of shifted also from the documentary field also into the contemporary art. So more and more I do installations, but the same reflection goes into the installation. All the research I do for my project kind of turn into installation processes. So like in my still images, the same reflection on editing is present. I investigate the archival image. I try to think how this is recycled, what are the latent images within these archives, how is the emotion of an archival images kind of generated when you reuse it. All these kind of thinking goes into this process.
And yes, your project is multimedia project. So let's come back to the idea of expanded, so different way of showing the work. So how do you conceive this multimedia work as multimedia?
Yeah, our work, I think, a lot of it is research based. So we've written articles. We've also mainly, experimented in different contexts of exhibitions. So even showing found footage, so similar to Rania. Stuff on where we've curated kind of programs of work that has dealt with natives and Palestinians in the past to kind of interrogate media representations of reservations and refugee camps. And that's been a big part of our practice. Writings, publishings, and the process of making short films and conducting workshops around those short films and asking people to produce their own work and then critiquing it. So that's been a big part of our process. We've also kind of been wanting to work on an exhibition, something with installations, photography, et cetera. Another part of our practice is to bring in, not only to present work on research and then present the research, but also to invite people that we've met along the way to present our research with us or to function as co-panelists with us as we present our research in university or different art spaces. So that's been a big part of it as well. That's the multimedia aspect of it. Maybe multimedia it's multimedia, but it's also beyond just media because a lot of our work is research-based. And I do see myself as a researcher and a writer alongside being a filmmaker.
Yes, and perhaps this question to all of you, this way of considering documentary and cinema, does this feed your way of thinking narrative Is it important for you to try to experiment different ways and after, okay, ah, yes. So I will imagine to have this kind of narrative because I will...
Absolutely. I mean, that's part of the reason we made all those short films was because, as you were saying, there's terabytes of footage and you can't possibly... It's a crime to leave all of it out and just stuff everything. Because, I mean, you can't just take the best footage and put it in a movie. That's not how it works. You have to have a certain narrative within the film or a certain logic, and then you see what from the footage fits in that logic. You can't just simply like do a best of hits of like your best footage and stuff it together. So when we would try to experiment with different styles. So one film that we made was kind of an older Palestinian guy talking about the Nakba and talking, giving a broad sweep of Palestinian refugee history. And then over that audio was shots of different camps. Another film we made was strictly footage of protests in the West Bank. Another film we made was documenting Pine Ridge for a Palestinian audience. And we had that film subtitled into Arabic so that, you know, people would understand it. So we experimented. We went to Standing Rock and we produced two films there. One was a kind of very experimental, slow, meditative, sensory look at the place. And the other was more of a piece of journalism that gave you a kind of idea of what was going on. Because the first, when we made the first film, Standing Rock was fairly new, people didn't know, so we felt that our task as filmmakers and as activists was to document it. But the second time that we went, it was already well known, Standing Rock, so we're like, let's try and capture what it feels like to be there, less in terms of what's going on. So having made all those films and all those different styles definitely helped inform how we would approach the feature, certainly.
I can say that the editing process for me is in order to reflect on the way a story is built in itself. It's not like applying a genre onto the content. For instance, an example, the last film I did, which is a short experimental film, I took a feature film from an old Egyptian film and I evacuated the fiction from the fiction, re-edited the film, leaving the threshold scenes in order to see how much of the fiction remains when you remove the fiction out of a fiction. So it's kind of pushing further for me, the interesting part, through editing, how do you push the story with it in a different way? How can a cut in a narrative expand the imagination of the spectator further? If you remove things and put two images together, what happens when you do this cut? How does the spectator reconstruct the narrative out of this lack, out of is removing something? So removing, adding, superimposing, what happens when two images are superimposed? It creates a third image in the eye of the spectator. So all these kind of relationship with the images, which are more complex, I try to push them because I'm interested in seeing, in trying different way in image works, and also stopping. I need the spectator to be part of this process for him to or her to think about what they're looking at. It's not only receiving the image. Is being part of reflecting on the image with me.
So in a way, yes?
Me, I'm just like really questioning the whole structure because in the 90s, people used to ask me when I was making short films, people would say, when are you gonna make a real film? And I'm like, oh, what do you mean? Feature-length film. I was like, okay. And then I started making feature-length films.
90 minutes or 52 minutes.
And I'll make feature-length films and nobody has attention span. Everybody's like, how can you make something that goes viral? So to me, it's just going like, I want to understand what is the language of young people because ultimately this is the people I want to engage to get more proactive. And it's been a real question. And I think in a way, nowadays, short films are more effective than feature-length documentaries because nobody has attention span. I mean, to get people to venues to watch a full-length film, people are always like, send me the link. They want to watch on telephone. So things are changing, and we as filmmakers, we have to adapt if we are not talking to walls, but to spectators that have completely different, you know, ways of wanting to see films and imagery and information.
So I would love to know what you guys recommend for filmmakers who don't want to be dinosaurs.
Yes, of course. Just you give me. Yes, if you want to take part of this discussion, of course you can. You can
don't
have
be shy,
a microphone.
Please.
Who wants to? One, two, and you first. And
hello. Excuse me. Thank you, by the way, for this talk. This has been really mind-expanding, and it kind of brings up a question that maybe is a little more political in nature. So, but I would like to hear the thoughts of all three of you, if possible. you know, when you were talking about this question of how can we keep young people engaged, I think something that comes to mind is creating a larger understanding of, I guess, the global moment, so to speak. I think for me, one thing that really stood out with Ayara's work is at the beginning you said that resistance is cultural, it's not politics, it's bigger than politics. And I think a lot of what we're seeing today, I think especially with this fascist trend that's kind of going on around the world, especially with what's going on in Brazil with Jair Bolsonaro and you know, with Donald Trump and figures like Steve Bannon, who's kind of at the head of almost this global network, it seems like, within Ukraine, within other parts of Europe, with this kind of growing extreme right. I'm wondering, how can we kind of pose this problem as a much larger phenomenon, like something that's bigger than politics? You know, I think fascism, in a way, is a spiritual disease, not necessarily a political movement. But that's just my personal opinion. I'd like to hear maybe what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, I think you pointed out something very important, that resistance is not just sit there and resist. It's actually a proactive thing. And this is what I try to also engage people, because people are like clicking the like button on Facebook and they think they're activists. And I'm like, no, you guys have to go and get more hands-on. And you know, a lot of times people say, well, I don't have extra money to donate, And I'm like, well, donate your time, you know, donate your skills, do something. And I think this is very important to bring to a reasonable level, because not everybody's gonna be a full-time activist. Like, this is what I do 24/7, you know? But not everybody can afford to do that. So people have to just figure out ways of allocating some of their action life for issues that concern not only them, but their families, their children, their grandchildren. And I think this is very important.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I don't think it's merely a political question. I think there's a civilizational question at heart here. And that's part of, I mean, within the project, we tried to focus on the indigenous and on the refugee, because I think those two archetypes, if you want, or those two realities as well, undermine, I think, the logic of the nation state, which I think is part of the, we're seeing the gross caricature of that now with all these right-wing populist movements spreading. So I think, and then there's also the question that you were talking about of resources and resource extraction. So I think ecology is part of it too, and examining our notions of citizenship, who gets to be considered a human being and who doesn't get to be considered a human being, and citizenship as the way you become human. And then if you're outside of that, it's like you're not registered as a person. And then as well, the extractivist relationship of governments to land. And so we thought by looking at indigenous models and as well as refugees in two different ways, we could both attack but also pose an alternative to the national model of thinking, which I think is part of the extractivist and nationalistic model of thinking, which I think is part of what's going on today. So I do agree with you that it's a reaction to a broader civilizational malady. It's not simply this or that particular political problem.
Is that working? Okay, yeah, yes. Great. Okay, perfect. What I find so interesting also in relation to your question and the presentation, thank you so much for all of your presentations, which is so exciting. And I'm thinking of Rania, that you, with your work, you question more or less the perception, and you make, let's say, the perceiver or receiver you question a kind of, how is the perception functioning? And you're questioning also a certain kind of mainstream, how, you know, like people are, let's say, educated unconsciously through the media, through the internet, through how films are curated or edited or whatever. And I think this is highly political because you invite, you know, to the receiver and you give also space and you ask in that space, you give also room. And so the person, the person who's looking or watching your films can decide what kind of stand he or she takes in order to react to your films. So I feel like that this, for me, is a very, very, very strong and very political way to actually engage in a very democratic dialogue as well. So I feel like as a one woman, you know, like, I don't know, you
production
know, like, it's very, very strong for me. And it has a lot of, you question also the responsibility of the other to engage with images, which I find really wonderful.
Thank you. Yeah, I think the resistance comes as an artist and filmmaker starts here. You know, like you have to counter the dominant narrative. You have to counter the dominant distribution processes. You have to counter the dominant way they want you to think. The shape of something, and on every level. You know, so this is how. Like totalitarianism can occupy all the space because when we recede in any single issue of these things, they take over. You know, we have to really resist on every single level. You know, how be conscious what we see, how to stop the flow of images, reinterrogate the image, reinterrogate the addition of images. Think about artificial imagery. What will it bring us? How can we deal with it? All these questions, and in our work, try to push further, slowly, slowly. I mean, I don't have the, I cannot change the whole thing. But on my small level, I try to push the boundaries. And I think in pushing the boundaries and making people aware that other possibilities are there. We open possibilities. We open possibles. This is what I try to do in my small way.
It was very, very interesting listening to you all. Thank you very much. I just have it's quite a practical question for all of you. I also work in documentary, and I appreciate and really love hearing, because I see a lot of young documentary filmmakers who are not really thinking about their audience. And the way, you know, you're using documentary as a tool or thinking about format in terms of the audience reception, I think is the key to the future of documentary, finding those different platforms and really targeting that message. But with that in mind, as you're getting more of a niche target and moving away from the traditional distribution models potentially, how does that affect your when you're fundraising? Does it expand your route to fundraising when you're targeting so much, or do you find that there's a conflict with these targeted audiences? Just out of curiosity.
Well, I don't do fundraising, I just self-finance, so I can't talk about that. But as far as distribution, I think it's very, very difficult when you are on the fringe and you're trying to get the film out there. So I used to be frustrated, but nowadays I just go and, you know, using social media, say, hey, you live in Lyon, where can I show my film there? And then I go after all the venues and people, and sometimes we show in the basement, sometimes university, sometimes big festivals, sometimes, you know, and everything counts. And I think in a way you have to be your own distributor, because you cannot expect a sales agent to get you a worldwide distributor when you're making fringe and highly controversial and political and aggressive films. So, you know, I just gave up on this idea of regular distribution, and I'm very proud that all our films, they show at least in 100 countries per year. So this is very much like intense. And I always tell filmmakers, people think filmmaking is the hardest thing. That's just 10% of the work. The work starts after you finish the film. And I think a lot of filmmakers get so exhausted that they are just like, they made these wonderful films that just sit there in the hard drive on the shelf because they just don't have the stamina. And to me, it's very important that if we make films, it's because it has to be seen. So we have to go very far and just be like, you know, harassing everybody in the world, like to get screenings happening. And lately, it's very hard, you know. Then you get the film booked, and then how do you get the audience to come? So it's like, oh my God, now not only have to get the film booked, I have to get the audience in each country. So it's very intense. But I think it's very important. I think this thing you said about, you know, the community, like, you know, you make food and you watch a film and you discuss, actually is very good, because I just made a film about agroecology and we are doing this format. We get everybody to come and cook and then we eat and then we watch the film and then we talk. And I think food is more attractive than film. So we've been getting a lot more audience with this format. So we have to be creative. We have to just come up with new ideas all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I second literally everything you said. Yeah, I don't know what much to add. I mean, I agree with everything you said. It's the same sort of thing with us. It's helping kind of form networks of people that you know, being involved in different spaces, in different groups of people, in different scenes, I think helps. And it's kind of forming grassroots communities of distribution. Some of them with different levels of institutional backing, but still kind of connected on a person-to-person basis. So that's kind of how it was. And in terms of funding, I mean, people who were sympathetic to the idea of the film helped us. But it's tricky. It's tricky when you don't have the kind of profit necessary to cover the film, and the grant world is kind of difficult to navigate, so it's hard stuff, and says the end here.
Yes, one last question, and very brief, please. Time is over.
Well, I have a question regarding the editing of documentaries. Like here, I understood from Iara that she prefers to have an editor, while Rania prefers to edit her own films. So I know that there is no right or wrong regarding this, but I wanted to know your opinions of how this helps in shaping the documentary, how each approach affects the documentary. Like when you edit your own film, you kind of have a background of what happened on set, how were you feeling that day. You know more than what actually appears on the screen. But when you edit someone else's films, you kind of have a fresh eye. How the two different approaches affect each documentary, and if some documentaries require this and others require that. Thank you.
I prefer to edit my own films because the whole thinking goes in the editing. Like it is constructed through the editing. However, when I finish the editing, I always need a fresh eye to look into the film because, as you know, when you shoot and film, you're very close to the material and you need to step back and see if anybody else understands the film other than you. So then you need this external eye. But for me, because the film is made in the editing, I can only edit myself because I edit in a kind of organic way, and also in it's a reflection, an organic, a visual, a perception. It's all the elements that are there in order to do the film. It's not just rational organization of material. It's layering, it's resonance between image and sound, it's images resonating among themselves, it's trying to push new ways of narrating, you know? So this is, you only can do it when you are inside the material, for me. But it's my own way of doing things. There is no like rule. The role of the editor is extremely important. When I edit other people's films, it's the first person who sees the material and has the fresh eye to talk about the material in a distanced way. And like Yara says, the editor is fundamental. They're not appreciated enough. Like DOPs are the gods and editors are like, but I think that the editors must be there, up there with the DOPs.
Yeah, I mean,
very briefly,
quickly.
Please.
Yeah, I mean, for us editing, yeah, I think it's definitely a collaborative process, and I think the importance of it lies, as you were saying, in having a pair of eyes that weren't there when it was being shooted, because on set it's Matt, I, and the DOP, but then we need someone who wasn't there, who physically wasn't on the trip, who didn't see these, who wasn't in these spaces, who wasn't physically at the place to kind of look at the footage and see how they make sense. So it will be a process where we'll kind of assemble things that we want and a broad outline of the logic, but then the editor comes in with this kind of leap where he gives us something to work with. So we get everything ready that we want, we assemble what we're interested in, the shots that we want, the dialogue that we want, a broad outline, but then they kind of provide the initial construction, that kind of leap forward. And then we work for a long time from there in terms of cutting it down and editing it from there. So we're there at the beginning and there at the end, but then there's this middle part where the editor is essential.
It's just a personality thing. I'm a very outdoors person. I love to be with my camera crew going about, but the editing is just so hard. You're in this dark room for months and months. And this is just where magic happens, but I have a very hard time being with the editor, but I am forced to. So I'm very efficient about filming, but when it comes to editing, things get stuck because you know, you can shoot a film in a month, but you need months and months to edit. But I'm very dependent on my collaborators, and you know, despite the fact that I'm not the editor myself, when we don't click, it just doesn't work. So even if I use different editors, you know, at the end of the day, say, oh, it looks like a film by you. So it's really about finding collaborators that you don't even need to speak, but they understand the same rhythm and momentum and the way and the flow you want the story to be told. So it's a very magical collaboration, and to tell you the truth, I mean, cameramen are important, but the editors are more, because they can even transform bad footage into amazing pieces, you know?
Or they could turn good footage into a bad
footage. That happens when you have an editor that doesn't understand what you're trying to say.
Yeah,
but,
thank you.
Yeah, editing is the magic.
Thank you. So we have to finish. So, as we have seen, so expanded documentary or expanded cinema is more a project, more a way of thinking cinema than a kind of fixed shape or fixed genre. So it's many things to say about this, of course. And perhaps we will continue this question with the next panel about anthropology and different way of making films and considering films. So thank you very much, all of you. Thank you for being there.